in the book. Karan Pratap Singh is poised to win the amateur boxing championship. He loses it all in a moment, and his failure seems to be rooted in his arrogance and short temper. However, the truth hides deeper in a childhood secret he has never shared before. Sonia Kapoor has her share of secrets too. One in particular that torments her every night, but she doesn't feel guilty for it. When these two people are thrown together by the hands of fate, their secrets and personal demons collide to stir up trouble. But can there be any redemption without forgiveness? Well, to tell you a little more about Nidhi, Nidhi is a writer and director based in Mumbai. She studied film.
Thank you. Well, I'll tell you a little bit about it. I actually began writing Dancing with Demons 4 years ago. And I wanted to tell the story of a man who could rise from his own ashes and claim his destiny. A fighter who was propelled forward by his passions, but chained to his demons. And I've been following boxing for a very long time. So for me, it was very interesting to take this fighter and throw him in the ring and see how that went. I also wanted to explore the possibility of a relationship between two volatile and fallen souls and see and figure if there was a possibility for love, for healing. And that's how Dancing with Demons started to take shape. Post that, I decided to go into the psyche of the two characters and figure a little more about Karan Pratap Singh and Sonia Kapoor. I in fact wrote their monologues first. So in the very first chapter, after Karan has lost the fight because he's banned from the sport for 4 years, he muses. He says, maybe I broke too many hearts, maybe I crushed too many souls, maybe my own heart was too broken to give a damn about anyone else's. Maybe the wise man is right. Life is like a boxing match. Tons of people will cheer you from the outside, but you're alone in that ring to fight your own battles. And then I turned my attention to Sonia, and I wrote her lines next. And Karan finds those lines in the book much later, in the novel. And she says, I know I'm not easy to love. On some days, there's no God above. And maybe it's a messed up world into which we have been hurled. And maybe I remind you of you. So love yourself, darling, to love me too. And from there, I wanted to explore further. I wanted to see where I wanted to go. I spent a lot of time developing the character, the plot, the structural balance. And there were good writing days and there were bad writing days. And I didn't give up. I was stubborn about that. I'd read a little passage, a very, very short passage for you from the book. June 8th, Saturday, 11 p.m. Jerry had kicked his door down and stormed in. Karan's face and body were sore with the fight with Savan. His left eye shut and bandaged. The doctor had stitched up the laceration. Jerry was drunk out of his mind. Karan had never seen him like that. Bloodshot eyes, unsteady gaze. He roared at Karan, "You messed it up. All you had to do was stay off the damn platform. I had trained you to do it, but you messed it up. You know what a four-year ban means? If you ever, ever make a comeback, which I'm not going to be a part of, you'll be too old to compete. You're finished, Karan. You're finished." I enjoyed exploring hope, resurrection, and human relationships in Dancing with Demons, and I'm quite looking forward to taking this story to the next level. And without much ado, I'd like to invite Mr. Mishra to please read some excerpts from the book.
Mr. Mishra.
Mr. Sudhir Mishra, sir.
She used to work with me, so she still hasn't gotten over this, you know, yes. This time you did, you know. We'll train you to say Sudhir. Right? So this is just an excerpt from the book. Thunder, rain, lightning. Thunder, rain, lightning, Mumbai was under siege again. A ring-like space lit with halogens, a parking lot in an abandoned, half-constructed mall just outside the city. Rough-looking men sat around under blue tarpaulin sheds, drinking, snorting, rolling joints, smoking up. Money was changing hands. A man went around collecting it. Madan was biting his nails nervously. He did that before every underground fight he put Karan into. Madan was a has-been fighter, a mediocre one at that. He was Karan's only support system during the darkness, effervescent, incorrigible, garrulous, and most importantly, forever around. Just the kind of friend Karan needed on most days. On other days, he was a jackass who put Karan in harm's way for a few $1,000. Tonight was the few $1,000 kind of night. The monsoon rain looked spectacular under the incandescent yellow gaze of the halogens. The makeshift ring looked surreal, as if the gods were about to fight it. It was unintentional, of course. The idea was to watch two wet and bloody fighters beat the life out of each other for a few $1,000. Primal. A burly man emerged from a van followed by Karan. 4 years had taken their toll. Karan was a ravaged version of himself, disheveled, sunken eyes, scars from previous fights visible, his eyes wise beyond his 28 years, wise like a man who'd seen rock bottom. Jerry would have been heartbroken if Jerry had ever looked back. He hadn't. Jerry had walked away from the Sawan debacle, severing all ties with his prodigy, shutting all doors on his favorite student. Karan looked at Madan and immediately understood. The bets had been placed on him and he had to win this one. Karan turned to look at his opponent. A drunken thug fired a round in the air from his country-made pistol and commanded the two fighters, "Nach Chhamia." Someone grabbed the pistol from his hand. The fool had shot himself in the foot on a previous occasion. The hoodlums roared and grunted as Karan and the muscle man went at each other. Not too far away, a Volvo passenger bus was slicing through the rain. Lightning revealed the face of a beautiful girl. She was Sonia. No older than 27 years, a slim face and large expressive eyes. Very expressive. The kind of eyes that needed to be hidden behind a pair of dark sunglasses to remain inscrutable. Black-rimmed spectacles sat clumsily over the bridge of her sharp, chiseled nose. Sonia was wearing a short, faded kurta over a pair of old jeans. Her thick hair piled into an unkempt bun. It almost seemed like Sonia was attempting to hide behind a cloak of ordinariness. Despite the drab clothes and disheveled hair, you could tell she was beautiful. Sonia sat silently at the window looking thunder in the eye, her calm exterior concealing dark secrets, desperately hoping that both she and her secret would disappear in Mumbai's cacophony and chaos, never to surface again. She hoped Mumbai would become the kind of friend she could trust her darkness to, and know the abyss would never betray her and never remind her of it either. Never, ever. She hoped she had left it all behind. The pain, the memories, the 5 long years spent in a daze. Surprisingly, life hadn't broken her. It had just made her stronger, given her the ability to protect herself from her own vulnerabilities. Her core, fragile and tender, like Karan, she was beautiful misfit. Starting over excited her, as did escaping. Life had thrown her an unexpected chance, and she grabbed it with both hands, gratefully, greedily. Her childlike emotional core saved her from her own darkness. If she could, she would have sat on top of the bus, taking on the rain, letting it wash away her pain. She would have liked to have lightning find her, course through her veins. She would have liked to electrocute it back. But right now, she needed to make that call to certain Madan Bhalla. Madan didn't take Sonia's call. He was too busy watching Karan and the fighter throw each other into the ground. Thunder struck hard. It was some night. Thunder and lightning playing, chasing one another like two furtive, carefree lovers, oblivious to the havoc they were wreaking. But he reads very well. Yeah?
Can I get the mic?
Hello, everyone. I've known Nidhi also for many years now. We met while working together on a film directed by that man over there, which we survived happily. And so I'm very proud to be here reading from her extraordinary novel. So I'm going to read my favorite chapter. All right. Karan reached Jerry's gymnasium just before midnight. Sitting on a bench not too far away from the gym, he watched Jerry go about his night routine, switching off the lights, closing the big iron doors one by one, barring the one small one he never shut. Even after all these years, he didn't get Jerry's logic of leaving the little one open. He watched Jerry retire to his room. Karan took a deep breath and looked around. The waters glistened. It was spectacular. The magnificence of the full moon night wasn't lost on him. The skies were clear, mirroring his state of mind. Still, taking in the silence of the night, Karan listened keenly to the soothing rhythm of the lapping waves. He watched the stars slowly waltz across the sky. In those moments, he knew it was time to cast his old self away. Karan knew he was living the most defining moment of his life, rising from his own ashes, phoenix-like. Savoring it, he sat still. There was no hurry tonight. There was nowhere to go. He was home. The night was progressing rapidly. Incoherent music came wafting to his ears from one of the apartments in the nearby building. Karan smiled. Someone else was awake too, alive to the magic of the transformative night. Yeah, I messed it up. But could it have been any other way? Would it have been fair if it had been any other way? What was wrong with getting what you deserved? Karan mused that the moon slowly started to fade away. Dawn was perhaps just an hour away. Karan got up from the bench and entered Jerry's gymnasium quietly. Through the very door he often quizzed Jerry about, the one that was always left open. He took a deep breath, breathing in the air of the gym, a mix of sweat, leather, and sea. He walked around lightly, running his fingers over the equipment, sighing. The speed bags, the sandbags, the rings, beckoning. He felt this rush of restlessness rise in his gut. He stood in front of Jerry's favorite sandbag, the one he kept taping up and never replaced, his heart beating wild. He plunged his fist into the bag, first the right, then the left. The bag flew in the air and came back at him. Karan grabbed it, eyes brimming with excitement. He picked up the first pair of gloves he could lay his hands on, put them on quickly, and went back at the bag. Bam, bam, bam.
So, boxing, let's begin there. Like, that's a very unique premise. You write action that beautifully. You know, you take us deep into the nitty-gritties of scenes as they are unfolding. So tell us a little bit about your writing process. Like, how did you get into boxing and how do you write action so well?
Okay, so I can't start by saying boxing and I go back a long way, because that will just sound... But what I will say is that I grew up in an armed forces environment that sort of exposes you to a lot of outdoors and adventure sports. And pretty early on, I actually watched a lot of boxing matches, live boxing matches. And I was quite fascinated by the fact the two men were beating the crap out of each other, pardon me. And the spectators were actually quite enjoying when the two men bled. And there was something very interesting in that for me. So when I went to study film, I started following boxing matches in New York. I'd go for all the pro tournaments that were happening. I started going as a fan. And in the book, I have used boxing as a metaphor for hope and resurrection. Really, because it's, for me, life is like a boxing match, so it's, that's Karan's worldview as far as the book is concerned. And I spent a lot of time talking to boxers, watching fights, going to matches. I met coaches, and given my interests in the outdoors and adventures, it only seemed natural that I'd set the story, a resurrection story, in the world of boxing. But I don't know what the hullabaloo is all about, because let's face it, the greatest boxing story coming out of India is not a man, it's a woman. It's MC Mary Kong. So, it is. So really, I mean,
there you go.
You touched briefly upon your process of writing as to why you wrote the story, how you imagined the characters. So take us a little bit at that level, at that point of inception again, as to how you conceptualize the story, what were the tugs again?
I think the greatest challenge for me was not to create these characters. They were both characters, Karan Pratap Singh and Sonia. I think the greatest challenge for me as a writer was to see what would happen when you threw an alpha male and an alpha female together. and would it work? Could they ever end up together? To me, that was very, and that needed a lot of writes and rewrites. It's very organic in the story, because it's tough for two strong people to find love in one way or another. So for me, I think that was a little bit, that was something I really enjoyed going back and forth. The love story that's there between Karan and Sonia. But I really, really enjoyed creating both these characters. And I mean, there's something that I said some time back is that Karan and Sonia are still coursing through my veins. And you know, I need to find a way to let them go a little and you know, let the book move on to the readers. Really.
Why do you think it will make a beautiful film?
Well, you know, I mean, it's difficult to make a, you know, I mean, for me, I'm a failed novelist, you know, I became a filmmaker because I couldn't be a novelist, it's too lonely, you know. So, you know, but it's two different things. And you know, you move from, in one, you move from the abstract to the concrete, and the other, you move from very concrete. Because you need things to shoot, you know, you need action. So, I mean, for this kind of book, because it's, you know, it's action, it's got to do with a sport. It's, you know, the film would deal more with the external and because it's, you can shoot it very well in terms, and with that you can sort of, in the nature of how you do it and the way you cut it, the way you shoot it, the way the actors perform, you'd be able to go into the interiority of their mind, whereas in the book, you can do more the headspace, you know, it's like, that's why sometimes, you know, sorry, but you know, I mean, for example, why is there not such a great sexual novel, you know, very different, because in the sense, you know, when it's, sorry, why is there not such a great sexual film? Because, you know, that's a thing that happens in the heads of the two people, and when it's just merely physical, it's like voyeurism, you know, it's very difficult to avoid that in film. It takes a very great craftsman to be able to move past that. But in this kind of book, it's because it's about sport, I think the transmission can be far easier. And because it's that, and I think it will make a really good film. But she's got it in her head anyway, that in the sense that intrudes into her writing, that visual sense of description, the way the film moves, the novel moves. I think it's easily transformed. Some books can, you know, some books can't. Well, it gives me great pleasure to announce that the film is being made from Dancing with Devu. Nidhi herself will direct. It'll be Mr. Arnav Singh in the lead. And I'm very proud because both of them work with me again. I don't know if Nidhi is my prodigy, but my little boy there is. So that's, you know, it really gives me great pleasure. And I think the producers are here and now we want to take this forward, but it will, you know. And I'll add my two bits whenever she wants.
All right, and followed by the wonderful announcement, I now invite Nidhi to give Karan Pratap Singh's boxing gloves to Arnavai. And I think we could just start it off on a better note. All the very best. All right. questions in the audience now. You could tell us about how, I mean, it's I'm sure a different process, a different journey when it comes to a book. What is it that you're sort of anticipating when it comes to the process of filmmaking and getting all of this down together into a movie? Would you think you would be able to do justice to apply all that into the book, into a movie?
So for starters, the screenplay is ready, so I think that's stage one. And filmmaking, when you write a novel, it's a slightly lonely process. You spend time with yourself, you put a story together. But making a film is a collaborative process. So you just ensure that all the right energies and the right people come together. And when everybody's together, all the right, the creative talent, the actors, people who passionately believe in the story, then I think half your job is done. Then it's really a question of going on the floor and shooting a film. So for me, I think I'm very fortunate that all the right energies have come together for the film. The producers are in the room. Arnold is here, Sir is here. I think everything's right, everything's perfect. I think we just need to go make the film now.
Well, and we can't end without asking Arnold about his thoughts. I'm sure he's really looking forward to this journey, and he can tell us a little bit about your association with the film.
I've been a fan of both Nithi and her writing since we worked together on Yesali's interview with Sudhir. And I've seen various incarnations of something that looked like this book, and something that looked like something else. And I've been very keenly following her developing the project. And I couldn't believe that she wanted me to do it, because it's an amazing part. And yeah, it's, I can knock a few people out, it's fun. But the kind of role, the kind of story that she's written is so full of depth and hope and redemption that I think it's got such a universal message that it'd be a joy to be a part of it. So I hope we get it together and get it done properly, worthy of her vision of it. And we will all try our very best to make sure we don't let her down.
Thank you very much, and we wish you all the very best, you and the entire team.
I want to thank Amrita for believing in me and for my ability to tell the story. I want to thank you, sir. I mean, I started my journey here all with you, and it's really special you're here. You're part of the journey. Onward journey.
I don't know why she keeps thanking me.
I do.
You did nothing. You know it's true.
My producers are also here. Magic Media and Productions, Navita and Kapil, thank you so much for believing in the film. And I'm looking forward to making this film with you and the Dream Catchers. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Please.
रोलिंग
सबसे पहले तो आपको बहुत-बहुत बधाई फिल्म की अनाउंसमेंट हो चुकी है, कितने खुश हो आप?
मैं बहुत ही खुश हूँ. हम लोग एक दो साल से इस ख्वाब को लेकर चल रहे हैं और आज हकीकत के तरफ एक कदम लिया, तो मैं बहुत खुश हूँ. इट्स एक कहानी है दो लोगों की जो सोचते हैं कि उनकी जिंदगी में जो समस्याएं आई हैं उनके आगे बढ़ नहीं सकते, लेकिन एक दूसरे के साथ एक दूसरे की मदद करके वो एक दूसरे को बेहतर बनाते हैं. और एक बॉक्सर है और एक, आपको किताब पढ़नी है कि सोनिया की कहानी क्या है, लेकिन कमाल की है. तो एक दूसरे के साथ वो कैसे एक दूसरे की मदद करते हैं और एक दूसरे को दिखाते हैं कि अगर आप अपने आप को कभी माफ़ कर दें हो रहा होता है तो फिर दुनिया भी आपको माफ कर देगी। मैंने वो पढ़ा था जब करण 4 साल बीत चुके हैं जब उसको उसका उसके बैन के बाद, और वो अब बॉक्सिंग के हिसाब से तो थोड़ा बुढ़ा हो गया। अभी 30 साल के जब हो जाते हैं तो फिर मतलब सब लोग 17-18 साल के हैं, फिट हैं, जवान हैं, तो थोड़ा बुढ़ा हो गया। तो वो जब ख्वाब देखता है कि मैं वापस जा सकता हूँ, मैं फिर से बॉक्सर बन सकता हूँ, मैं तरक्की जीत सकता हूँ, लेकिन उसको सिर्फ अपने पुराने कोच के साथ काम करना है जिससे वो 4-5 साल से उन्हें एक शब्द भी नहीं एक दूसरे से कहा है। तो जब पहली बार उसके जिम में रात को छुप के जाता है बस खड़े होने के लिए और महसूस करने के लिए जहाँ पे वो पला बड़ा है, तो उसके दिमाग में जो कुछ चलता है वो मेरा फेवरेट पार्ट है।
जी नहीं,
उनको ज़्यादा एक्सपीरियंस फिल्म में, वो शॉर्ट्स और टीवी फिल्म्स, और सुधीर जी के साथ हम लोग ने पोस्ट प्रोडक्शन में काम किया। उनकी एक्चुअल स्पेशलिटी फिल्म है। अभी वो लिखते लिखते उनने एक नॉवल लिख दी, तो क्योंकि वो कमाल की लड़की हैं तो हो चुका, लेकिन उनका फिल्म के बारे में उनको कोई कुछ नहीं सिखा सकता। फिजिकली बदलना पड़ेगा पूरा शरीर, मतलब जैसे हैं वैसे तो बॉक्सिंग नहीं कर सकते क्योंकि वो शरीर अलग टाइप का होता है, उसका फंक्शन अलग है, उसका स्टैमिना अलग है, उस जहाँ मसल ग्रुप्स हैं वो अलग हैं, उस सब हाथ का है वो तो सब यहाँ का, उसका कुछ है ही नहीं। तो ट्रेनिंग तो बहुत करनी पड़ेगी, मेहनत तो बहुत करनी पड़ेगी, लेकिन खुशी से करेंगे और खून पसीना के साथ करेंगे, वो तो आप चिंता मत करें।
थैंक यू।
जी मैं बहुत खुश हूँ। आई एम वेरी लकी एंड आई एम हैप्पी कि ये किताब पर हम लोग पिक्चर बना रहे हैं। बहुत बहुत 4 या 5 सालों से इसकी किताब की लिखाई जारी है, तो अब इस पर हम बहुत खुश हैं कि हम इस पर पिक्चर बना रहे हैं। सारी करेक्ट एनर्जीज पिक्चर के पीछे हैं, हमने पिक्चर आज अनाउंस की है, तो ऑब्वियसली मैं बहुत खुश हूँ। ये किताब ये कहानी एक बॉक्सर की कहानी है, और ये बॉक्सर है जिसने किताब की शुरू में अपनी ज़िंदगी का सबसे इम्पोर्टेंट मैच खो दिया है, और वो बैन हो जाता है, और उसके बाद पूरी किताब में उसकी जर्नी है टू कम बैक, सो ही नीड्स टू मेक दैट जर्नी फॉर होप एंड रेजरेक्शन। तो एक पर उसका एक डीमन है, एक बचपन का एक सीक्रेट है, एंड ही हैज़ टू कम टू टर्म्स, ही हैज़ टू कम टू ओवरकम दैट सीक्रेट एंड दैट डीमन। तो इसलिए उसको कहते हैं डांसिंग विद डीमन, क्योंकि जो बॉक्सिंग रिंग के अंदर जो दो फाइटर्स जब लड़ते हैं तो वो थोड़ा बहुत एक डांस की तरह है। अगर आप ध्यान से बॉक्सिंग की फाइट देखें तो थोड़ा बहुत डांस की तरह है, बस फर्क ये है कि वो जो दो डांसर्स हैं वो डांस करने के बजाय एक दूसरे को मार रहे हैं, पर उसमें उसका रिदम और उसका पेस एक डांस की तरह है। सो दैट्स व्हाई द बुक वाज कॉल्ड डांसिंग विद डीमंस। और वो जो डीमन है वो उनकी जो अंदर की एक जो उनकी लिमिटेशन है, वो लिमिटेशन को जब तक उस लिमिटेशन को फाइट नहीं करेंगे वो चैंपियन नहीं बन सकते। सो ही मस्ट वैंक्विश हिज डीमन to fulfill his destiny. So that is dancing with demons. Thank you so much. You're most welcome. Thank you.
मैंने नहीं बनाया, वही बना रही है। फिल्म बनेगी इस पर अनाउंस कर रहा हूँ मैं, और जो भी मैं सुझाव दे सकता हूँ एडवाइजरी कैपेसिटी में रह सकता हूँ मैं रहूँगा, क्योंकि निधि ने मेरे साथ काम किया है, मुझे बहुत टैलेंटेड इंडिविजुअल है वो। किताब बहुत ही अच्छी है, बहुत बारीकी से लिखी है, बहुत ग्रिपिंग है, बहुत जो किरदार हैं उनके अंदर बहुत मानसिक चीज़ों में बहुत अंदर बहुत कमाल की तरह से घुसती है। उसका जो बॉक्सिंग सीन्स हैं जिस तरह से वो डिस्क्राइब्ड हैं वो बहुत अच्छे हैं, बहुत एक्साइटिंग हैं, बहुत अच्छी फिल्म बनेगी। किताब भी अपने आप में बहुत अच्छी है, दो किरदार बहुत ही अच्छे हैं, एक जो मेन हीरो हीरोइन बोलें या जो मेन प्रोटैगनिस्ट बोलें बहुत अच्छे, और मैं बहुत ज़्यादा इम्प्रेस हुआ इस किताब को पढ़ के।
बात, लेकिन बुक को जो है बड़े पर्दे पर उतारना कहीं ना कहीं काफी मुश्किल होता है, तो उसके लिए क्या कहना
चाहिए? नहीं, किताब लिखना भी उतनी मुश्किल होता है, बट बड़े पर्दे पे उतारने में अपने चैलेंजेस होते हैं, और वो उसको आता है, वो ट्रेनिंग ट्रेंड है, मेरे साथ काम कर चुकी है, बहुत बहुत टैलेंटेड लड़की है, उसको सिनेमा आता है, ऐसे ही नहीं बना रही है क्योंकि मौका मिल रहा है, बट उसको फिल्म बनानी आती है, तो वो मीडियम से उसमें उतना इन्वॉल्वमेंट है, वो स्क्रीन प्ले भी लिखना आता है उसको, तो अब वो किताब से स्क्रीन प्ले जब लिखेगी तो उसमें भी एक जो उसका तब्दीली होगी उसमें, वो भी इंटरेस्टिंग होगी, वो पढ़ना चाहूँगा मैं, और मेरे ख्याल से बहुत अच्छी फिल्म बनाएंगे, और जो कास्टिंग उसने की अरुणोदय की वो बहुत अच्छी है, और बॉक्सर का जो एक स्पोर्ट्समैन का जो एक पार्ट है वो बहुत सूट करता है उसको। नहीं नहीं अच्छी है, आई थिंक इट्स अ मोर मतलब अपीलिंग फिल्म, और वो एक होप की फिल्म है, एक तो एक्शन है तो वो अच्छा है, और एंड में एक होप है, तो एक लव स्टोरी है बीच में बड़ी इंटरेस्टिंग, तो मेरे ख्याल से सबको अपील करनी चाहिए।
और बुक में से कोई खास मोमेंट ऐसा जो आपको पसंद आया हो स्पेसिफिकली चैप्टर्स?
मैं वो अब मैं ऐसे पढ़ता नहीं हूँ, लेकिन मतलब वो जो किरदार उनका है, जो वो लड़ाई हारता है, जिस तरह से वो डिस्क्राइब्ड है उसका मोमेंट, जो जो पूरे फाइट्स हैं, जो उनका डिस्क्रिप्शन है, डिटेल उसकी जो डिटेल है वो बड़ी कमाल है, उसके मानसिक दिमाग में क्या चल रहा है, जो वो लाइट एक बाहरी लड़ाई चल रही है, एक अंदर उस बॉक्सर के दिमाग में क्या हो रहा है, बहुत अच्छे से डिस्क्राइब है, बहुत अच्छा। मैं मेरे बारे में थोड़ी ना ही है यार, मैं तो अलग काम करता हूँ, मेरा मैं तो और देवदास बना रहा हूँ, और बन चुकी है आधी से, 90% फिल्म बन गई है, मेरा 10 दिन का शेड्यूल है दिल्ली में, बस मैं तो वो बना रहा हूँ।